Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I want to welcome everyone here this morning to our triad meeting. We have a few numerous things to go over. First of all, we start with the department heads. Barbara, the director of the Council on Aging, who is the one handling funds, the treasurer. So Barbara, I don't know if there's any changes or not.
No changes. We still have $1,455. So it's
no income and no deficit.
No. But we are here to help people, you know, with the safety LoJack program and all that. So if you know anyone that needs it, somebody with autism, dementia, or Alzheimer's, that's what we're here to do, to fundraise and to help them with the safety LoJack. One of our programs, right?
Yeah. Is there anything that you want to say while I have you?
Yeah, I got plenty to say. Since we have the cable, I want to remind everybody that the old IUOK program is now called the Safety Assurance for Independent Living Program. I do prefer the old one better because it's so easy, IUOK. So anybody that's, you know, at home alone, you can call them, we can sign you up, and you'll get a call, an electronic call between 6 a.m. and 12 o'clock, you know, especially if they're home alone and you're worried about them, they're a loved one. And we have a few people in Halifax that are on this program, but we like to sign people up all the time. The other program we have is our file of life, the regular file of life. It's magnetized, and there's actually a pocket one in here for your wallet, with all your medications, all the statistics that are important. And then we have a new program with a picture ID. If everyone can see, that's my picture. So we take another file of life with all of our important emergency information in the picture, and we put in our glove compartment. And then there's a sticker that goes on the back window. So if anything ever happens, we see it on the news all the time. You get stuck in your car for 5 days or 6 days or whatever. You know, somebody finds you, you're unconscious, they have all your information. It has saved people's lives, so that's one of the programs that we're trying to do also.
This also helps the fire department if you have a call, so that they know exactly if it's on the refrigerator. When they go into the house, they know exactly what person it is, what type of medication they should be looking about. So it's a great help to the fire department, the EMTs, and paramedics.
And the other, if you notice in the police lobby, it took over a year to get that. Looks like a big post office box, but it's red and white, and it's for old medications. You know, people are on the street, you know, with the drug problems that are around. So you can take the old medications. You don't have to be from Halifax, even. If you live down the street in East Bridgewater, you can drop them off, and they're in a safe place, and they will dispose of them properly. Uh-oh, got a telephone call. Okay, at the Council on Aging, I just want to remind people we have the big annual cookout on August 19th at noontime. So we have tickets going on at the Senior Center at $6. We try to keep the price low. We have a gentleman from town that's doing the entertainment, so that will be a big surprise to everybody. And we have a big ice cream social tomorrow. And again, we have to outsource because of the space issues that we have at the Council on Aging. So the ice cream social will be at the Halifax Mobile Home Park. We have exercise classes at the Town Hall. We do have one on Fridays at the Senior Center. And also, we're very happy to have the statewide evidence-based diabetes self-management program that will be starting in September. And it will go from noontime to 12:30. And all of this is, for the most part, free of charge for our seniors 60 and older in the town of Halifax. So it's all in the newsletter, so if you have any interest in anything, you can pass on this information to other people, your neighbors, and we'll be happy to sign you up. And that will be it for me.
Okay, thank you, Barbara.
You're welcome.
So, secretary report.
Okay, the triad meeting from June 9th. On June 9th, the treasurer's and secretary's reports were not read to allow time for the officers to attend the Plymouth County Sheriff's Cookout. COA, Barbara thanked all participants in the 1 mile walk on June 3rd. There were 60 walkers. The summer cookout will be August 19th at noontime at the Town Hall Lawn. Library, on June 15th at 6:30, information about ticks. Local Audits Night will be on June 22nd, 6:30 to 8:30. Our speaker for July 14th is Jim Keegan. He will discuss the town recycling program. August 11th will be Kimberly King and Harry Town, who will talk about ticks and their bite. Today's speaker, Kathy Drynan, Halifax Health Agent, and Dan Daly from the Plymouth County Mosquito Control, discussed how to protect yourself from these pests. The time to call for spraying is when the mosquitoes are bothering you. The spray has no residual effect and must be applied every time mosquitoes are around. The spraying is free. However, weather conditions must be right for the spraying to be done. Spraying starts June 1st for residential. Wetlands and swamps are sprayed in April to kill the larva. Always keep yourself covered to avoid bites. Check labels on repellents. Use only as directed, and don't allow water to pool around your property, allowing mosquitoes to breed. Meeting adjourned at 11:15.
Thank you, Sue. With the department heads that are here today, I'll start with the DA's office. With Chris, you have something that you might want to talk to us about as far as the September meeting or whatever.
Well, things are still in the works right now. For our September meeting, we want to go over to the Plymouth District Court for a tour. So we have to figure that out in the time. And I guess you guys need to decide, are you going to have a meeting first, or if you're just going to go directly to the Plymouth District Court? So we should maybe speak afterwards about that, about, you know, what's the best way to proceed.
Okay. Now, is that with the Sheriff's Department too, or are you doing this with the DA alone?
It will be probably a joint venture there.
Okay.
But this is the first meeting since the Sheriff's Department. I hope barbecue. I thought it was a great turnout. I hope you guys enjoyed yourselves.
Yeah. Excellent.
Why don't we do a quick business meeting?
We can skip the business meeting.
Okay.
What we might be able to do, Chris, is skip the actual business meeting and meet at the where we're going to meet you.
At the Plymouth District Board.
Yeah.
Okay, that's right next to the Sheriff's Farm.
Right.
Yeah. That'll be perfect.
Okay. Should we sign it up that way, or you still want to make sure?
No, I'll talk to Barbara when I get back, but that sounds good right now, so 10 o'clock at the Home District Court.
That's okay.
And what's the date on that? That's the second Tuesday in September.
Second Tuesday.
Yes.
Okay, great.
September, that'd be September 8th.
Yes.
Wow.
So anybody that would like to do that, is there a maximum number of people? Or?
No, I'll look into that to see what we kind of have planned. I'll keep you guys posted on that.
Okay, great. So whoever wants to sign up, just let us know. You don't have to be 60 or older. You can be 59 and have
The only thing is try not to have to be a member of the courthouse down there if they know who you are. You know what I mean? What was it, 10, did you say 10 a.m. or 10:30?
10 a.m. I'll shoot you guys an email all the logistics.
Okay, great. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Are you going to have the list to sign?
The people are here today, if you want to sign up, we can sign you up. Before you leave, sign up.
I'll leave a paper right up here. How's that?
Okay, good.
Right here. And I already signed you up.
Okay.
Joe, you have something to mention about the generations and things at the mobile park.
Well, I can't really tell you anything about the mobile park right now because it's at a standstill. We're waiting for the Stacy to get her environmental protection people in there and see what's what, the groundwater and the septic systems. And we have a swamp way down in the back, too. I'm sure that's something they'll have to look into. But until she gets her people in there, we can't get our people in there and see what the findings are. So right now, we're just sitting on our hands waiting for somebody to make a move.
But people that don't know about this, the mobile park is for sale. And that's what they're talking about, is who's going to buy it and who can buy it and who can afford to buy it and so forth. Mm-hmm. That's what Joe's mentioning, is right now things are in process, but the park is for sale.
And it will be quite, from what I understand, it's going to be quite a lengthy process too.
Yeah, it would be.
Yeah. We don't have any problem getting the money. It's all the politics and everything else that goes on in between. So anyway, then Generations is going to have a meeting on the 24th of this month at 11:30. It will be hot dogs and hamburgers and maybe a surprise or two. Ken's cooking.
I like mine red.
He's only cooking because I told him he could have a hot dog for free. So that's going to be a $5 deal for that meeting. And we want to get some new ideas and some input about officers and who will be interested in running for certain offices. And somebody that has any new ideas about anything, events or anything, please come forward and let us know. And you can always call Dottie Martell. She's never home, but you can always call her. October, we're going to go to the Nickerson Theater and see 39 Steps by Alfred Hitchcock. And then by popular demand, we're going to have another go at having lunch at the Lantana with the doo-wop people that were there before. Everybody had such a wonderful time, I understand, that they really want to go back again, and that's going to be in November. And that's pretty much it for right now. So, thank you. Here she is.
What?
It's a terrible time.
You know what? Joe, do you know what offices they're looking for on
every
the generation?
Office, October is the end of our fiscal year. We have offices must be voted in at that time, and we want to find offices just about every president,
space.
Vice president, secretary, treasurer, because these people have done it now, and it should be passed on to others. Can't expect the same people to do the same all the work all the time, except me and you.
Well, how often do you meet?
We meet once every 3 months approximately, and then we try to have events in between.
What is she talking about? What are you talking
Generations.
About? Generations.
Keep with it, Myrna.
Myrna over there.
I didn't know if you were talking.
And I have to say, they do an awesome job, because they're our fundraising
agents. They do great work, and
they've
accumulated
very
a lot of money for Barbara to use for things that she wants. We've gotten her desk chairs, folding chairs. We've gotten her
tents.
Oh, God, the tents. So that we don't broil out in the sun during the picnic. All kinds of things.
A grill.
The beautiful grill. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Very nice.
So the funds that Generations comes up with, it's a good deposit going to the Council on Aging.
The funds from Generations can only be used for the Council on Aging and its building.
Okay.
Only.
Thank you.
Okay.
We have Laurie from the library. Anything, Laurie?
Sorry, I was late. Yes, we have a lot going on at the library, including our summer reading activities for children preschool through grade 6. So that's making the library a very busy place right now. But we do have other things going on. The senior singers will be coming back to the library in August for a concert, August 25th, I believe,
yes.
Tuesday afternoon. You can always check our news on the online calendar on our website, homespubliclibrary.org. And we have assistive technology for anyone who is having trouble seeing or hearing. If you want to participate in a group or come to an event and you have trouble hearing, you can ask us for the assistive technology and we can provide that. So come on down to the library and see what we have to offer.
Okay, thank you. Fire Chief Jason, what do you anything you want to mention this morning?
Last month we finished up going through the park and doing the house numbering program. I think we found 14 different units that didn't have numbers on them. More importantly, we found a lot where the numbers were put down so low that the shrubbery was actually blocking the numbers. So we found quite a few, and we just wanted to mention it wasn't just exclusive to the park. We just started there as a pilot program, but if there's anyone else that needs us to come out, we'll help put numbers on the house, that type of thing. We've also This month done 4 or 5. We've found, while we're out on calls, 4 or 5 different houses without working smoke and carbon monoxide detectors. And we just want to remind people to make sure those are working. And a few cases where people weren't either able to afford them or to install them themselves, we're more than happy to come out and assist with that also. We have some funding to provide smoke and carbon monoxide detectors that, for people that can't afford them.
Okay. Thank you.
Good job.
Kim.
Hi.
Board of Selectmen, is there anything that you want to mention at all, you or Troy?
No, I don't think that we have anything. I just wanted to verify the date of your cookout will be on August 19th. Is that the date? On a Wednesday?
Yeah, that's our, okay. Our cookout for across the street.
Yeah.
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 Nice
crowd. It's a great time.
So you can make sure we have that space.
Yep,
available.
I'll make sure with PM that it's on the calendar.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to introduce to you, I was going to give us some information because we're all wondering about Comcast, when we're going to have TV, and when we're going to have things that we had before, and right now is in process of being done. So I want Richard, who is the executive director of Comcast of Section 58. Richard, could you come up and give us a little information? Where does Halifax stand now?
We're getting things together. Programming is filling in as we are able to. It's Area 58 Community Access Media now. We're funded through the Comcast fees. We aren't technically Comcast. We're a separate 501c3. And we're trying to get everything in order with what we need to cover in Halifax and what Halifax would like to see covered. If you need to get in touch with us, you can. Probably the easiest way at this point is to call us at 508-866-1019. We also have an email address. We have about 87 email addresses right now.
Can you just repeat that again,
sure.
Please?
508-866-1019.
Okay, thank you.
And
so if we need anybody or anything cableized,
yep,
we can call.
Just give us a call. Now, we're only the access center. We can't control what Comcast is putting into here or how the internet or anything like that's working. We only control channels 13, 14, and 15. 13 is the public access channel, which is basically any citizen in any of the towns we cover, which are now Plimpton, Halifax, and Carver, can come in and do a program of their own, and we'll train them on how to do it, train them on how to edit it. It's all free of charge to the citizens of those towns, and we'll air it on channel 13. 14 is your education channel, which will be anything from Silver Lake, or it's shared with Plimpton as it always has been, so we'll have any of the school events from the two towns there as well. And 15 is the government channel, where you'll have any of the meetings we're covering for the town of Halifax and Plimpton on that channel. So if there's any boards that need to be covered, they need to get in touch through the selectmen, through Charlie Seelig, and let us know if the board needs to be covered, and we can figure that out from there.
Well, for instance, Triad, how would I have to go through with a selectman first before you? How would I handle to have you doing like you're doing today?
You can go to John Chabon. Talk to John, and John will make sure that we know that it needs to be covered and we'll be there.
Okay.
Generally, the way it's working is we're hiring contracted videographers to do the actual shooting. Then they bring us back the footage. We edit it and then put it on the air. So we can augment the audio and fix any video issues that there may be. Usually they do a pretty good job and there are none, but sometimes we have to lift the audio a little bit so it's easier to hear. And we're working on getting the bulletin board up to speed. We've been working with the library on a few things and getting their pages up. And if you've got any announcements, like different events, please feel free to give us a call. We'll give you some more information about how to get us the information in a proper format. We can then get up on the bulletin boards so the people in town can see it.
Can I get a copy of meetings? Like
yes,
what you're doing? Is that possible to get
Absolutely.
A copy?
As long as we know you need them, we can get them for
okay.
you.
I'm looking for one from when Jason, our fire chief, did one back, I believe it was in May. He did a terrific job. And I'd like to get a copy of that one. Also, Can any of these be replayed? When are these channels going to be in operation?
They are in operation now.
Which would be on channel 15, right?
Yes.
For what we're talking
15,
about.
Yeah.
Can those be replayed so that the people can see and listen
to
them?
They play a bunch of times. So you want some of the older ones replayed?
Well, that one there I'd like to have done because I don't know if that one was done at all. Because I know it was when you were in the process of moving from Halifax to Carver, and then Plimpton wasn't involved somewhat.
Right.
So I wasn't sure if that one ever got played at all.
We'll take a look, see if we've got it, and we can definitely get that replayed.
Okay.
Put that back up.
Could you let me know then on that one?
Yes.
And I'd like to get a copy of that one too.
Okay. Yeah, just let John, give me contact information
to
John, and that way I can let you know.
Okay, thank you.
We also have been putting the meetings in town on YouTube. So you can go to YouTube and directly connect them there. We also now have Area 58 Community Access Media as a Facebook page. If you go there, the link to the channels is there. So you can go right there and get directly to the Halifax YouTube channels.
And that's called Area 58?
Yes. If you search Area 58, you should be able to find it. If you don't, add in Community Access Media. And
I got
it, definitely
yeah. It comes right up.
Okay, good, fantastic. Thanks, Kim.
I miss any of the department heads? If not, is there anyone else that has anything they want to say before we put our speaker on? If not, you found we mentioned about the speaker for August, and that's going to be Kimberly King and Harry Towns, and that's going to be. Why we have why Harry Towns is involved, because he's had a real hard time with tick bites, and he's going to be part of the program with Elizabeth King. So and that's going to be on August the 11th. So we go with our speaker today. Where is Jim? Jim Keegan, probably everyone in here knows Jim Keegan. He's been around for a town, not just on council, not just on the recycling, but he was also a police officer for around 5 years or so. Then when he retired from that and gave up his gun, he decided to do something different, and he got involved with the recycling somehow. He'll tell us how. And right now, if you ever saw the recycling center before Jim took it, and you see it now, you wouldn't think it's the same place. It's immaculate. You wouldn't even know it was a recycling place. You could go in there and have a picnic table on the place. It is kept so clean, so neat, inside and out. Jim, you did a terrific job, and you're still doing it. You want to come up and tell us a little bit about how you're doing it?
Thank you. That was quite a compliment.
It's true, Jim. It's true.
I have to warn you, this is low tech, and I'm using an overhead projector, and you're going to be blinded if you sit there.
Well, we're going to move away. When you get to that point, we'll move away.
There are a couple of people in here that may not know me. As Kenny stated, I'm Jim Keegan, and I am the recycling attendant for Halifax, which means that I'm the guy that directs recycling traffic. Like I used to do traffic when I was a police officer, now I do recycling traffic. That plastic bottle goes there, the paper goes over there. But thank you for having me, and thanks for coming. And many of you I consider friends, and it's very nice being here with you. I hope we're gonna learn something this morning, and I'm sure I'll probably learn something if we get into any discussion. I'm always learning something. I have to warn you that it is low tech. I'm using this overhead projector, and I made some clears, which we'll put up on the screen. I just want to explain, though, I'm an expert at nothing. I've been doing recycling for about 4+ years, and I have learned something. I probably know more than the average recycler, but I'm not an expert. A lot of what I'll discuss, I took off the computer, I went to government sites, business sites, and it's comes from some of my experience at the recycling center. So if we all learn something and we leave here knowing more than when we came in, then I've been a success. So, are you going to stay there? Because I'm about to turn this on.
okay. You should have gave us a warning.
Oh, no, if I turned that on, you would have been, you wouldn't have seen anything for the rest of the day.
The lights, Jim, are right over by the door there.
Okay, this is, if I could call these slides. That's technical. Halifax Recycles, and oh yes it does. Halifax is an excellent recycling town, and I want to explain something to you. Susan is the coordinator. I answer to Susan. Bob Badua runs the whole show down there. He's the highway surveyor, but he runs the recycling too, solid waste. And Susan answers to him. But Susan, when it comes to the technical aspects of recycling and if we're looking for grants or any way we can get help from the state, Susan's the girl to go to. She's the one that looks these things up and she knows how to pursue it. She applied for a grant recently. I think it was for like, it was a small grant, $3,500, which is small, I guess, when you look at some of the needs towns have. But when we got that grant, we were, I should step back a little bit. We have a DEP person, Department of Environmental Protection for the state, who rents an office at the recycling center where her host community. She takes care of all the recycling centers from, I think, South Weymouth down to the Cape. She advises them, she helps them out with any technical things that they should need from the state. And she told us when we got that grant that we are very highly rated. The town of Halifax, you are very highly rated by the state of Massachusetts. We come in second to that grant, and the whole state,
wow,
we come in second.
Excellent.
So that's how this town is recycling. Yeah. Okay, so like I say, we do recycle. I used to wonder, why do people use slides and read them? Can't people read that? Well, I guess it's just what I'm going to do here this morning. Okay, what is recycling? The Environmental Protection Agency describes recycling as the process of collecting and processing materials that would otherwise be thrown away as trash and turning them into new products. Recycling can benefit your community and environment. It's very succinct. It's very well said. Thank you for the Environmental Protection Agency. What are some of the benefits of recycling? I took a lot of this, as you see it, off the EPA's website. That first bullet point I put in there because I want to discuss it a little later. But savings to residents on the cost of trash disposal. If you're a good recycler, you'll spend far less money on getting rid of trash. Reduces the amount of waste sent to landfills and incinerators. We're all interested in that. We've been burying ourselves for years with this junk. Now we're doing something about it, and recycling is a large part of that. Conserves natural resources such as timber, water, and minerals. Prevents pollution by reducing the need to collect new raw materials. Save energy. Reduces greenhouse gas emissions that contribute to global climate change. A lot of people don't believe in this global climate change, and they don't feel like greenhouse gas emissions are causing it. I happen to be one that does. And no, I'm sorry if I offend anybody, but I think we are little by little destroying this earth. Maybe we can turn it around, but we've been doing a fair job of destroying everything. It helps sustain the environment for future generations, helps create new well-paying jobs in recycling and manufacturing industries in the United States. I like that, in the United States. Yeah, let's bring industry back. We don't have much of it going on today. What I'd like to do is get through these and then we could discuss it point by point. Okay, getting the facts straight. An average American generates about 4.6 pounds of solid trash per day, 1,700 pounds a year. That's what the average American, that's the refuse from an average American. Proper handling of this waste saves energy and money and protects our natural resources and environment. All right, here's where I wanted to was talking about if you're a good recycler, you can save a lot on your trash. Examples of trash disposal costs in Halifax when recycling while using town trash bags. I know that for those that live in the park, they have their own collection. But like I was explaining earlier, this could be a benefit to the residents of the park too, because their trash collection fees won't be going up, or they won't have to go up if they're good recyclers. They can keep everything stable. Small bags, one per week, you would spend $26 every 3 months. Two per week, you'd spend $52 every 3 months. On the large bags, one per week is $39 for 3 months. Two per week, $78 for 3 months. I was bragging at the center while I was working about how little trash I put out because I'm a good recycler. And I was explaining to someone that I only do one bag every 2 weeks of trash, because those products that you shouldn't put in your trash bag, I recycle. So I'm not filling up my blue bag and wasting $3 on stuff that I could get rid of for free. So this person told me that they're doing one large trash bag every 2 weeks also, and that under this scenario, wait a minute, let's see, proficient, yeah, okay, one large trash bag every 2 weeks, and under this scenario, their cost for 3 months now is $19.50.
Wow.
$19.50. So that's less than the park has made.
Yes.
By 50 cents. Because you pay $5 a month. Yeah. All right. Okay, how does recycling save energy? Recycling saves energy primarily because it reduces the need to extract and refine natural resources. The energy needed to recycle many materials is less than the energy required to make it from scratch, even after accounting for the energy involved in collecting and sorting recyclables. That means the trucks that had it, truck that, the diesel fuel that has been expended, everything added up is still cheaper than getting it from scratch, raw materials. If we recycle these materials, it's still cheaper than getting raw materials. Okay, now, recycled plastics, which we get a lot of, recycling sand. Recycling a single plastic bottle can conserve enough energy to light a 60-watt light bulb for 6 hours. Recycle that bottle, and you can light a 60-watt light bulb for 6 hours. That kind of puts it in a way you can understand, doesn't it? Recycled plastic bottles can be made into products such as clothing. I remember years ago, I used to do some screen printing, and they came out with these shirts made from plastic bottles. And I said, yeah, but I don't know, can you print on them? And so I got something. Ooh, you could print on them. And they had a soft feel. What a soft hand. They were so comfortable. They were really nice t-shirts. They were made from plastic Coke bottles.
In the United States?
Yes. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. I haven't been looking for them, but I haven't seen any lately. But they're around. I did see one recently, but I wouldn't know where to get them. I bet if you go online and you Google it, you could probably find them.
Yeah.
Also make carpeting, detergent bottles, and lumber for outdoor decking. This is my show and tell box. I wasn't going to print it out this soon, but Trex decking? That's what the deck they're talking about. But I'm going to discuss that a little more in a while. The production of plastic accounts for 4% of all the energy consumption in the United States. That's the plastic industry. It's 4% of all our energy. Which, you know, I say 4%, but 4% of everything we do, that's a lot. That is a lot. Here's the next case. Recycled glass generates 20% less air pollution and 50% less water pollution than normal production of glass. It uses 50% less energy. Recycling one glass container saves enough energy to light a 100-watt light bulb for 4 hours. Show and tell. Right there, if that container was recycled, there's 4 hours of a 100-watt light bulb. Just that one thing, container. I should leave these up here because that is impressive. So give us something to look at. This is a good one. Now, I didn't bring any show and tell on this because we're talking a ton. And that would mean 2 bales of cardboard I'd have had printed to this room. Okay, so. Couldn't do it. The elevator wouldn't have taken it either. Okay, recycled paper. Recycled paper cuts energy usage by 60%. And its production uses 80% less water. Recycled paper generates 95% less air pollution. Recycling 1 ton of paper saves 17 trees. Not little trees, these are big trees. 7,000 gallons of water, 2 barrels of oil, and 4,100 kilowatts of hours of energy. Enough to power the average American home for 6 months.
Wow.
And every year, enough paper is thrown away to make a 12-foot wall from New York to California. You can build a paper wall from New York to California. We've got to get better at recycling. Recycled aluminum. Aluminum only uses 5% of the energy and emissions needed to extract new aluminum. That means they use bauxite and aluminum, that's strip mining, and it's got a little more of what makes this earth a mess. Recycling one aluminum can saves enough energy to watch TV for 3 hours. Okay. That can, 3 hours of watching television, that was recycled. Okay, some facts that are unique to the Halifax Recycling Program. Now, you'll notice that I highlighted currently. The reason I did that is because 2 of these programs are mine, and not everybody was happy with it. Why are we doing that? Well, I don't know if we should get into that. And I'll explain as we get to those programs. But first, currently, Halifax has what is known as a co-mingle system for recycling. Under this system, we separate paper and cardboard products from containers of plastic, glass, and metal cans. In other words, if this bin were curbside, all we want to see in it is what you see here. These containers, plastic, glass, and metal containers. Any paper products we want either in another bin or bagged or tied together. We don't mix. It can't be mixed in our recyclables. The reason being the truck that we use, the recycling truck, is set up with a partition. The front two, I don't know, is everybody seeing the recycle truck work? How it lifts and dumps? We have like, I call them saddle tanks on the side. The back one is paper, the front two are plastic, glass, and cans. That truck works strictly on gravity. It's not it doesn't compact it. It just dumps it in, and when it's full, you take it and dump it. Now, we have to differentiate between the paper products and the plastic, glass, and cans, because when we go to dump the truck, we open the tailgate, get the PTO, the truck goes up, and all the paper comes out.
What's the PTO?
Oh, I'm sorry, that's the pneumatic controls to make the dump. I'm sorry, I'm talking like a truck driver. I'm actually a retired truck driver. I did 36 years as a truck driver. But after we dump the paper, we go across the street and we dump the plastic, glass, and cans. Then we hit a lock button, a switch in the truck, that opens or releases this wall that we have inside the truck. And when the truck, when the back of the truck was up this time, that wall swings open and all the glass, plastic cans come up. So that's why we have to separate. We're a commingled town. Soon, I don't know how soon, it might be a year, we're getting a new truck. Well, no, we're getting a new truck in less than a year. It should be October or November. And that's going to be a compactor. That, when we get that, there's a possibility we are going single stream. Single stream means you mix paper, glass, plastic cans, everything together in your bin. Because it's compacted, it all gets squashed together anyway. So we will then be a single stream town. I was always kind of against single stream because one of the last few incomes we have as a town is the paper products. We do make money on the paper. When we go single stream, because it's mixed in with the plastic glass and cans, we lose that income. When I first started this job, we used to make money on plastics and the glass and the cans. It wasn't a lot, but it took the curse off of the cost of the program. We pay for that now. When we dump the plastic glass and cans, we actually pay them to get rid of it. There's no more income there. So when we go single stream, we're gonna lose the paper income also.
Why do it?
Well, we're dinosaurs in the recycling industry. We're one of the very few towns left that are commingled. And everybody, all the processors, processing plants, they're all going single stream. They're not gonna be able to accept this as commingled town anymore anyway. We could go there and dump as a commingled town, but they're gonna charge us like we're single stream. All right, EPS, commonly called styrofoam, is prohibited from curbside recycling bins and the dumpsters at the recycling center, also the truck. Of course, when I say the curbside recycling bins, I'm sure you'd understand that I mean the truck also. It's not recyclable in that manner. Although it is very recyclable, styrofoam presents many problems for collection and processing systems. For one thing, EPS expanded polystyrene is what that is. That's Dow chemical. Styrofoam is Dow Chemical's name for EPS. That's more popular. Like I say, it is very recyclable, but the problem with styrofoam is you can have a tractor trailer load of it and you have nothing. It's not a saleable product. You don't have enough to sell it. So, because it's 98% air, and no one's going to spend a tank full of diesel fuel to truck 98% air to a company that, you know, when they crush it down and compact it, it would probably, that truckload would probably would be about as big as that chair in size. Now, I started, unlike other communities, we do accept this product for recycling at the recycling center, but it must be clean, it has to be free of tape and labels, and it has to be deposited in a container that I have up at the recycling center. Now, those are the rules. Does everybody follow them? No. Whenever I go to Rich is my go-to guy when I need help breaking up that styrofoam and bagging it. But a lot of times we're so busy up there that we don't see what people are putting here or there. And at the end of the day, when I start looking at the styrofoam that I have to break up and put into 60-gallon bags, very often there's tape and labels on it. And it takes a lot of our time. I'm a 20-hour-a-week employee. And there's only so much you can do in 20 hours, but when you start bogging us down with tape and labels, and there's other things that I will talk about that don't work very well for part-time employees. So, anybody that brings styrofoam to the setup, please. Just remember to try and keep the tape labels and make off it, or take them off. We want it dry, we want it clean, because that's what the processors insist on. And we always give them a good product. They're very happy with what we bring them. Now, what do? I break it up, I put it into 60-gallon bags, I stack it on the side of the recycling center, inside. And when I get 35 bags, I go up and I borrow a truck from Highway. I throw the bags on the truck, and I run them over to Bridgewater, Insulation Technologies. They take it, and they crush it down and blow it into a big, it's like a big plastic envelope hanging from the ceiling. And then they can fill their containers with that. They ship that up to Framingham, which is reform it. Reform it, then sells it on the open market to industries that use it to make. Codainers.
T-shirts.
CD cases. That's polystyrene. That's made from styrofoam. See pictures on the wall. Picture frames. Oh yeah, here's a frame. That may be styrene. Picture frames. Your cheaper, you know, when you go in and you buy your sunglasses, the ones in the drugstore, not prescription, they have the cheaper frames. That's styrene. Yeah. So there's a lot they do with styrofoam. And that's just a few things. I mean, there's tons of things they can make with it. They can also make new containers, coffee cups and whatever. Let's see, how far did I get on that? Any questions on the polystyrene? All right, then we'll just move on. Now, plastic films, that's another problem. We don't want plastic film in the truck, in the curbside recycling bins, or in our dumpsters up at the recycling center. Plastic films such as market, bread, and newspaper bags are prohibited from curbside recycling bins and the dumpsters at the recycling center. This product creates problems for the processing plants where we send our recyclables. The plastic bags and sheet goods, that's all like shrink wrap or sheets of polyethylene, they get entwined in the separating machinery and cause serious downtime for the processor. They have to shut their operation down because someone has to physically go in and pull all this stuff out of the wheels and the gears. They don't want it. So if anybody wants to recycle plastic film, what I suggest and what I hope for is they're going to bring it back to Stop and Shop, Market Basket, Shaw's, Target. They accept it. They take it back. They're in the program to take it back. Now, what can you bring back? Not just market bags. It's polyethylene film. You know when you bought the case of bottled water? Same thing as the supermarket bags or, you know, shopping. You opened that. You got a great deal on Bumblebee. You got those four cans of Bumblebee. You took that wrap off. Polyethylene. Same thing. That goes back to, yes.
Is it marked so we would know?
Okay. They sometimes are. I don't know if Acadia does it. It should be. I don't see a marking on theirs. And I have a problem with that. I want to call all these companies that don't identify what they're using for wraps. Oh, okay, Robert. Thanks for having me. But rest assured that if you buy a case of bottled water, that is polyethylene. And if you get a four pack of tuna fish, that's polyethylene. Oh, the way you can tell, when you go like this, it has a crinkle to it, but it's a soft crinkle. You can take your fingers and stretch it. That's acceptable. Unlike Ritz crackers, the cardboard is very recyclable. But we'd rather you didn't, you took that wrapper off. Now here's the difference. That's not acceptable. It doesn't stretch. That's trash. That goes in the blue bag. Potato chip bags, trash in the blue bag. You bought those nice Nabisco crackers. Came in a bag, trash. When you open a lot of these bags up, you see aluminum inside, they're aluminized, it's trash. It can't be recycled, it's trash. and we don't want it up there. Now, on these plastic films, we accept it at the recycling center. And this is much to the chagrin of the powers that be. They didn't want me to do this either. What I had done is I put a box up there because people bring their recyclables in plastic bags. They go up to the truck, and it was hoped that they would dump them into the truck. Now, what do you do with the plastic bag? We don't want that in the truck. What, had a box down here? Just throw it in there. Okay. Well, that box went from about this big. I now have a box this big, that tall, and it is always overflowing. Because people think, well, I don't have to worry about bringing them back to the market. They take them at the recycling center. And I said, oh, it's that. It's been working. I don't know how much longer we can continue with it, because here's the problem. When people come in and they bring their market bags in, quite often, there's stuff full. So I take them, now I have to put them in a 60-gallon bag, because I'm going to deliver them to another place that accepts these things. Well, actually, right now I'm taking them to Walmart, and that's another story. I'll explain that in a minute. But I go like this to make sure it's that soft feel and that they're all polyethylene bags. And I've gotten, my fingers are educated now. I'm telling you, I've got a wonderful sense of touch, and I say, they left the paper, the receipt in there. They don't want those paper receipts, so I tear the bag, and I put my finger in, I get that paper receipt and pull it out. Hopefully, I don't have to take all the bags out. I get the paper receipt, and I don't have to open the whole thing. But then I feel the other side, that doesn't feel right. I take it out, and there's a cookie wrapper in there. So I'm trying to give them a good product, because I don't want to come back and say, hey, we can't take your stuff anymore. It's trash. So we try to keep all this clean polyethylene together.
I put my newspapers in a plastic bag, mm-hmm. and put it out with recycling.
And I'll tell you why it's fine. It's suggested you put your paper in a paper bag. What are you doing on a rainy day? I don't want to be out there collecting and picking up a wet paper bag and everything. Well, no. Things like that we can handle. If some of the stuff gets through, they expect a certain percentage of this stuff to get through in the system. If some of it gets through, like your plastic bag that's holding all those papers, that's fine. Yeah. But although it is preferred that residents deposit plastic film in the containers provided at markets, certain department stores, and home improvement stores, we currently, you notice I use that word currently again, because they can drop the boom on me and say, no, we're not taking those anymore, but currently accepted at the recycling center. All film, bags, sheet goods, etc., must be clean, dry, and free of tape and labels like clean styrofoam, and deposited in the container provided at the center. Yeah. Now, let me show you what we accept for these items. Show and tell. This is styrofoam. Does everybody understand what the styrofoam is? You know the feel? It's kind of stiff. We also accept the trays that you get, like you bought your hamburger patties at the market. We accept those. They have to be as clean as the dishes that you put back in your cupboard. That's what I tell people. I want them rinsed clean, so yeah, nice and clean. Because I took this out of my recycle. Coffee cups. We don't want leftover cream and coffee in it. They have to be clean. And some people say, well, why? Why? It's just trash. I said, no, we don't collect trash in Halifax. We have Harlan Brothers doing that. We're a recycling center, and we give our processors a clean product. We want it that clean. This also goes in a 60-gallon bag. That's delivered to the same place that the rest of the styrofoam is, but they want it separated because they call this shred. They do it differently, and they sell it on the market differently than they do the regular styrofoam. This is also number 6 styrofoam.
Hello, Sarge.
All right, now, I wanted to bring this up. Because I see that he bouncing back and forth, but does anybody understand this? What this is?
Packing.
It looks like styrofoam, doesn't it?
Yeah.
It's not. See, it's spongy.
Oh, okay.
See, it's not hard. It's spongy. This is polyethylene. This is low density polyethylene, expanded polyethylene. This is expanded polystyrene.
Absolutely.
It is confusing. But all you have to know is that if it's spongy, if it's, it's all puffed up like this, it is spongy. Here, feel it.
Oh, yeah.
Does anybody want to feel it? Did you get the difference? That's everybody. Okay, that's polyethylene.
Is that good or bad?
That's good. That's the same stuff as this.
Okay.
That's the same stuff. Oh, your bread bags?
Yeah.
They bring those to the market or up to the recycling center too. They go with this. That's polyethylene.
So this can go with plastic bags?
Yes.
I can throw that in?
Yep. Yeah. You can bring it back to the market or you can bring it up to us. Yeah. Now see.
I put it in the trash.
Well, what, this here?
Yeah.
Oh, no. These are recyclable. They are polyethylene. The only thing we request is that you shake them out. Get the crumbs out of them. That's all. We just don't. We don't want ants up the recycling center. Well, we have ants, but we don't want any more. Okay, so we have that. We have this. Now, remember you got that gift that was wrapped up in the bubble wrap? Polyethylene goes with this.
That's my favorite toy.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Everybody loves that.
Yeah.
Very charming.
Now, what do we do with that? Put it in with, you don't have it in with the cans and
No,
the
it
plastic.
Can't go, it can't, you can do nothing with it, curbside.
Bring it to Wally's.
Oh, you can.
No, you either bring it back to the market.
Okay.
Or to Walmart.
Okay.
Or bring it up to the recycling center. Well, see us. We're nice people. We're happy to see you. Wanted to see us. Bring your recyclables to us.
Jim,
and we'll
if
take
it. Take it back to the market. Do they have a place where you put it?
They have. When you walk it in, they have a. We're stopping shops.
Right up front.
Yeah.
Right in the bottle room.
I've seen that.
Right in the bottle room and right up front.
Okay.
I thought it was just the shopping bags.
Yeah, no, they'll take all this stuff, and I'll tell you why they'll take it. Because they are selling it to truck makers. Stop and Shop makes money on that.
Wow.
They bail it and sell it to trucks.
I never realized all this.
The only problem for us as a town, or me as a worker, they started limiting me. We get a lot of this stuff in. And I've got 14 bags, 60-gallon bags this big. They weigh about 25, 30 pounds. And I remember I went to Stop and Shop, and I had been burning it for a while, and I went in and I had like seven of those bags. And I was told, we can't take that like that. I said, what do you mean? I was told, we take it. You people make money on it. No, we don't have the room. We don't have the space. No, you're restricted to 3 bags at a time, and they can only come in on Wednesdays and Friday mornings. I'm open to the public on Wednesdays. I haven't got time to be running plastic bags up there. And on Friday morning, I don't work, so I can't. So now I've been going to Walmart, and I bring 15 bags at a time. And ideally, I try to time it with the 35 bags I'm bringing to Bridgewater. So I get the big truck, bring it up to the recycle center, throw 15 bags on it, go up and see Walmart, and they bail it. They bail it right there. And they take it in the back room. Then I go up and I fill up again with the styrofoam and go over to Bridgewater. So I get it all done in one morning.
I never realized how involved recycling was.
It's very involved. And it's very, very frustrating and confusing for the average resident until you get it. And then I have people coming up there, they're like my police officers. They walk around and say, Jimmy, you know what they just do in the truck? I said, oh, I'll take care of it. Don't you say anything, don't you get more, I'll take care of it. I have people, I tell them, like I have people come in and someone will say something to them, and I'll say, no, you leave that print. They're exemplary. They're one of my exemplary recyclers. I've got to get gold stars for the better ones. Let's see if I have any more assurance. I don't want to get ahead of myself. Okay. Household hazardous waste. Of course, we do that too. Household hazardous waste is accepted at the recycling center on the first Saturday of the month. We used to take it all the time. I remember when I first took the job, I thought it was like other towns, they have like one day a year or 2 days a year they have the hazardous waste day.
What does that include?
All hazardous household chemicals.
What about oil, like from the lawnmower? Would
yep.
that be included?
Yes. Yep. Stuff, that nasty stuff that you have under your sink, and it gets down to so much, and you're not using it anymore, and you know it's nasty, you don't want to just throw it in your trash, you don't know what to do with it. You read the can, if it says caution, be aware, do not, you know,
yeah.
bring it up to us.
Okay.
But it's once a month, because when I first took the job, it was, when we were open, we took it.
Yeah.
Wow, the stuff was piling up, it was all over the place, and I'm supposed to be logging this and putting it in cabinets, and up 20 hours a week.
Yeah.
I'll do it. So finally, Susan, the town, sent me to a class on hazardous, handling of hazardous waste. And although it was a little over my head because it was more for the industrial hazardous waste company, big companies, chemical companies that are producing large quantities of chemicals, you know. But I did learn a lot there, and it was very enlightening, and I did come away with a lot of ideas. And one of the ideas I came away with, and I went right to see Susan, I said, Susan, we're not taking it every day. Once a month. You know, some towns only take it once a year. Once a month is good for everybody. And it's the first Saturday of the month. That way I can get ahead of it. I can do it. I have a whole month to get that stuff put in cabinets or poured here or, you know, whatever we have to do with it. So it's once a month now. Now, what we ask is that residents call prior to bringing their materials to the center, make certain that the material is acceptable. What do I mean by that? Examples of unacceptable items: unlabeled chemicals, products in rusted containers, products from business or industrial sources. We don't take that.
What do we do with it?
Unfortunately, there is something to do, but it gets very expensive. You have to call Clean Harbors or a like company. I'm not here advertising Clean Harbors. I should mention all of them, but they don't.
I don't think
right
people
now.
Will do that. I think they'll just throw it in the trash.
Unfortunately, or worse. Yeah, they can throw it in the woods. It gets into the water supplies.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
But we can't handle it because we're not chemists.
Yeah.
And if we have a rusted can sitting around that recycling center, how do we know that won't rupture? Give off fumes that affect us
sure.
in some very dangerous way. And if it's not labeled, I've had people come in and I say, what is it? Oh, I don't know. Where'd you get it? Out of my shed. Well, what do you want me to do?
So what do we do with it?
You have to call one of those larger companies and they handle that stuff. They have chemists on site. And they will identify it, then they'll charge you. They do it on a per pound basis, they say. But if it's less than a pound, they charge you for the chemist that has to identify it, and then the disposal. They're up in, there's one in Braintree. They're all over there. You know, they could be found in the people that we hire to take all the stuff out of the recycling center when we finally had it, and we have too much, we're gonna get rid of it.
So if they had a product like that on their premises and wanted to get rid of it, they could come to you and you could give them the name.
Yes.
The names. Of,
names.
Of
we them. Wouldn't give them one name because we're not advertising for any particular company.
Okay.
What we do is we shop around. When we want to get rid of that stuff, we find out who's going to be the best price at this time to handle. You know, we have to mm-hmm. watch the town's pennies. All right, use hypodermic needles in sealed, hard containers and items containing mercury may be brought to the center at any time. That I've separated from the other hazardous waste because when people get a small container of hypodermic needles, bring them up to the center, bring them up now, all right? We've had people come in as recently as a couple of weeks ago that actually filled one of our boxes with hypodermic. Detergent bottles full of hypodermic needles. So what have you been saving them for? How long have you been saving these? You know? But so some people, I don't know, they just don't get an opportunity to get the hypodermic needles put away what you should.
Chief Broderick will also collect those here. Or at your home if you have a number of them.
Yeah. we don't do house calls. Yeah, bring them to us. And then mercury items, I don't want that stuff hanging around your house. If you've got mercury items, in today's world, you shouldn't have any mercury items. We had a program that if you had a mercury thermometer, bring it up to us, we gave you a digital one, free. You know, give us a mercury, we'll give you a digital. Thermostats, you shouldn't have mercury thermostats anymore. That's old technology and it's bad technology.
How do you know if the thermostat?
Well, if you take the face off, the little plastic face off, yeah. And you see a little bulb in there with this little silver thing bouncing around in there, that's a little wad of mercury. Mercury batteries, rechargeable batteries, many of them have mercury in them. You don't throw them in the trash, you bring them up to us. They don't go in the recycling bin either. They have to come up to us and we handle them. Now that can be brought anytime because that stuff's so nasty. We don't want you thinking about it and letting it hang around your house. Burn it up. Get rid of it. Get it out of your house. Burn it up for us.
Is it true though that regular batteries now you can just throw in the
trash? Yeah, it's trash. There's nothing hazardous in them to the environment. And they say they're recycling those now, but I read up on that, and it's more expensive to recycle those than it is to make a new battery. I think it's just, I think some of the companies were going after, was it Rayovac? I think they had a green battery, and it's a recycled battery. I think that's just a marketing ploy. Hey, see what we're doing, we're recycled battery. You know? But they say it's more expensive than making a new battery.
Jim, the batteries say on the mercury?
Yeah, if it has mercury in it, it'll say it contains mercury. Yeah. Unless it's so small they can't put the print on it. Some of these little tiny button batteries in it.
The only one we had was a small one that was without alarm system.
Yeah.
They put it in the
We want those batteries. We handle those differently. We package them differently. Any mercury item we package differently. Oh, and the fluorescent light bulbs. And your little squiggly bulb, you know, we want those up there too. They have mercury in them. And if you bring a bulb, if you break a bulb, don't get all panicky. You know, I mean, there's worse things that can happen. But you want to contain it, you want to clean it properly. And you go on the computer, it'll tell you how to clean it. But mainly, you just don't want to raise dust and you don't want to be trying to sweep it or vacuum it. If you vacuum it, you ruin your vacuum. Right?
It's
yeah.
A good thing
because you have mercury in your vacuum now. But what you want to do is you want to take wet paper towels and bring it all together, and then you want to get it into a container and make sure you clean it up with that damp paper towel. And I probably should let Jason, the chief, explain this one. and then you bring whatever you have left over, the fine glass and the supposed mercury. It's in the container, whether it's a heavy plastic bag or whatever, you bring that up to us and we'll get rid of that. If you come into us and all of a sudden you open your car and you say, oh, that bulb broke, let us know. Don't hand us a bulb. You know, and then I'm talking to someone, I pick up the bulb and all of a sudden I see stuff all over me, you know. Let us know that the bulb has been broken and we'll take care of it.
So what do you do if you spill it on yourself? You have to go change immediately, take
it. I have these wipes that it collects mercury, and I very slowly take it off me and then throw it away.
Wow.
I'm not putting that in my washing machine.
Wow, this is so educational. Are you saying that all of these new energy efficient light bulbs that
mercury.
We're putting in our houses are all
mercury.
Mercury?
Yes, that's what I'm saying. Yeah.
Wow.
They're squiggly fluorescent bulbs, is all they got.
But I thought they were supposed to be better for the environment.
Well, okay. When you say you got to qualify that, better for the environment. Well, part of what's good for the environment is using up less energy.
Right.
In that sense, it is better for the environment. But you don't want to break one.
They don't tell you that. Yeah. It's not on the package.
Well, you know, I think a lot of things fall through the crack. You know, there's a lot of assumptions today that people strew them. Everybody knows that mercury is dangerous. Do they? Like television, why do you charge $15 for me to get rid of my television here? Because the glass is lead? It's a poison? And they have to handle that, they have to handle that differently than they would anything else. They charge us to handle that specially.
Speaking of TVs,
yeah.
Where now are you getting rid of the TV? Were you taking them to Brockton?
No, they burned down.
Yeah,
we
know,
used to deal with you.
Yeah, I know, but that's what I was asking. Where are we taking the TVs now?
No, we stopped dealing with him 2 years ago.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I won't get into
what
that.
What about microwaves? Okay.
Yeah, those, now they have that, what's that tool? They're $5 to get rid of up there because there's some hazardous waste in those.
Oh.
Yeah, the trash bag numbers for those. Yeah. Right, you don't have to be writing these amounts down. I'm going to give you a price list.
Dehumidifiers too?
Oh, good.
Dehumidifiers, which you have to pay for the Freon charge. Humidifiers, they're just metal. We throw that in the scrap metal. But there is Freon and dehumidifiers. They have a refrigeration component, just like a refrigerator or an air conditioner. Yeah, we charge for that.
How much?
$10.
Almost cheap.
Fuck, glad.
He's right down prices.
Okay. Well, that's my presentation.
Very good.
Wow. I do have one last thing. This is about the biggest thing we want in the recycling truck. See, people don't understand the recycling truck. We take containers, plastic cans, and that's the gallon size is about the biggest thing we want in there. And cardboard 20 inches. Because as I explained earlier in my talk, it works on gravity. We don't have it doesn't compress everything together. It works in gravity. It fills up pretty quick. So if you have if someone tries to put laundry baskets this big in the truck, it's not gonna fit. Okay, any questions?
Jim, on that bottle there on St. Bill Cotton, you can step on those and crush them down. Is that anything?
That helps.
Oh,
anything like that helps the collection.
Well, it helps me because I can get more in a bag or something.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I do that myself. I squash it and fold the bottom and the top over it and then put the cap back on. And because I squeeze all the air out of it, when I screw the cap back on, it stays flat.
Caps on?
Yeah, you can leave the cap on.
Oh
yeah, we've gone long past the day. Remember when we started recycling? You had to take labels off the bottle.
Yeah.
You had to take the metal ring off the top of the Coke bottle. You know, all that stuff. I wasn't a recycler back in them days. I said, baloney. I'm not doing that. I got a private contract. But then after a while, I started saying, I'm paying this much every 3 months for some guy to take my stuff away. And I could be paying this. It was a no-brainer.
Yes. With our customers, I put an awful lot of the paper towels and stuff into the plastic bags and tie them up and leave them. Am I creating a problem for them by doing that?
Are these used paper towels?
Yeah.
That's trash. No, it's trash.
Is it okay to put them in the plastic bag and tie it up and leave it at their door? Or am I creating a problem for them?
No, as long as they're putting it in with the trash. Because once you use a paper towel, it's trash.
Yeah, it's just Windex and, that sort of thing.
Do you take old lawnmowers that they have? Do you remove the gas and the oil?
Take the oil and the gas out of it, and of course we take it. The town makes money on it. Burn it up there, we throw it in our scrap metal.
Okay. How much is it?
Nothing. We make money. That's how many. Any metal, scrap metal, we make money on.
Awesome.
Now, how much do we make? People say, oh, yeah, the town's working to kill one on the metal. Cost us I think it's $170 to have that bin, that dumpster taken out, dumped, and brought back in. We don't make enough. It takes the curse off of helping people get rid of their waste. Okay.
Jim, isn't it a Massachusetts law that you have to recycle?
Yes.
Against the law,
since
even
the
90s. If you have a private hauler to take a plastic bottle, put it in your trash, and throw it away, is against Massachusetts law.
That's actually illegal.
It is illegal. The same with a can,
yeah.
A Coke can, a vegetable can, any cans. It's against the law. It's not
since
extremely
the 90s,
enforced.
They
but
add stuff to that list. Like you cannot brick, concrete, stuff like that, that has to be handled in a certain way. That can't just be thrown in a landfill anymore. Wood products. It started, in the night, well, I think the latest thing was in the year 2000, it became illegal to throw CRTs or televisions in trash. But prior to that, they had other things, like I said, bricks, mortar, concrete, and they've been adding to this list all along. I mean, the list is probably that long. The things that cannot go into landfills, they have to be processed. They have to be processed, yeah, and used in other, like glass. A lot of glass, you know, goes into asphalt now, and they say the roads will last longer with the glass and the asphalt. Yes, Bill.
I have a hard time putting together what I really want to say here, because I think what you have covered here is just the beginning of my game, which is education. Mm-hmm. And it's not in our public schools, but this is a real public problem. And it's, I would say, tops mathematics in importance. The knowledge, the information which you've got here, and what we're going to pay in terms of health and finances and success in terms of all of those things, because we don't educate. We talk about it, we complain about it, but we don't teach about it, and we should.
I think you're right.
So
very well put.
Very nice.
But
another vocation for you, Jim.
Yeah, well, I don't know what I want to be when I grow up, so.
Better watch out, Joe. He'll put you down there. I've been down there a lot, him and Bob. Bob and him does a good job.
How does the park compare with the rest of the town to recycling? Do you know that?
They do very well. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I picked up. I do run the recycling truck if Bill is off on vacation or he's out sick or whatever, you know, once in a while. That was part of my getting this job, that I was required to work a truck occasionally. And thank you, Lord. Bobby Matur has been very good. It's been very occasionally, not very often. Bill works hard. That's a tough job.
Yeah, it is.
Tough job. There's six routes in this town. That's why it's every other week. He works Monday through Wednesday. And like I said, there's six routes. He does three routes this week. And those three now will not see him back for another 2 weeks.
Right.
So,
if you see him, bring him out a cold bottle of water.
He's a good guy. Works hard.
So
and I can swear that, testify the fact he works hard, because I've done his job. I've walked in his shoes, and I don't like it.
And always a perfect gentleman, Jim.
Jim?
Yes.
This big fire they had in Brockton, that salvage place, what effect does that have on stuff that you have now? And where would you be taking it?
None, because we don't do business with CRT. They're on East Ashland Street.
Yes.
Bill, the recycling truck driver, called me Monday morning and said, "Hey Jim, I don't know what I'm gonna do." I said, "What do you mean?" He said, I'm trying to get BFI. They burnt down." I said, "No, it ain't burnt down. Round the corner burnt down. BFI's on Mulberry. CRT's on East Ashland."
So nothing that goes there.
No, we used to deal with them.
Yeah.
But we've stopped dealing with them. Yes.
On the single stream recycling, so you mix everything together.
Everything.
And then it has to get sorted eventually, though, doesn't it,
yes,
down the line? But that's more efficient.
There's a processing plant that will sort that. Does sort that. And right now, BFI, where we take our recyclables currently, Rocket, they accept both single stream and commingle. They have two bays for us for the commingle, and then they have. The other way around. One bay for us to commingle, two bays for the single stream. They have a conveyor belt, and they take their front end loader, and they go in, they scoop an enormous front end loader, and they scoop it up, and then they go over to the conveyor belt, dump it on a conveyor belt, it brings it up into the building, and it goes out back into these tractor trailers that don't have a roof on them. Have you ever seen those big trailers that you notice that the roof is going like this because it's a rubberized or canvas roof?
Yeah.
It's been tied. Well, that's what they dump this stuff into, and then they bring this top back and they strap it off. And then that track material brings it to a processing plant where they use magnets air, heat, they have all ways of identifying. Well, you know, a person have to stand there, oh, that's metal, and that's paper, this plastic. Yeah. They have machines that do it.
Yeah.
Like they blow air into it, and anything that's light, and it's, you know, will blow off, and it's sometimes that's very light plastic, or it might be dry paper or something, and they know what they're doing with this stuff, and then it's, you know, the machines separate it, and they have screens. The screens that, you know, shaker screens and things like that. They have all kinds of ways of separating it, but it's amazing. The technology in that, but the single stream is coming, and we don't have to worry about how they process it. The only thing we have to worry about is the fact that we are losing the paper income. Although we will still have the paper bins up at the recycling center, so you can bring your paper there if you want to. And the cardboard, we still bail the cardboard.
And the newspapers should be separate from the.
Well, right now, but when we go single stream, they won't have to put it all together. Yeah. The I just had a thought that just went in my head. And,
you know, oh, welcome to
right
my
out.
World.
I was going to explain something about the cardboard. Oh, cardboard. When I first started on the job, which was 4+ years ago, we were getting $140 a ton. Now cardboard is down to $52 a ton.
Wow.
We're making $26 a bale, a half a ton bale. We're making $26 a month. But we hang in there because it'll come back. It goes up and down.
You're going to give us a price list?
Yes, I am.
There you go, Grandma.
No, I don't want to forget anything.
Would you like a price list?
I
know. Just be a bunch. If anybody that doesn't get one, I'll make sure they know.
Thank you.
Also, you don't need a bit. There you go. Now, what I'm handing out here, this is a.
Okay.
Now, what I've just handed out, in the event that you had to bring something up to the recycling center that isn't recyclable, free, these are the current costs of these items. You know, well, it's self-explanatory. Furniture, rugs, electronics, appliances. The electronics, the only electronics you have to be concerned about as far as there being a cost is televisions and monitors, computer monitors, because they're CRTs. They have leaded glass in them, they have nasty chemicals. But all other electronics, if you want to bring them up there, they just go in the bin. There's no charge for those. And then I have one more handout. Am I taking too much time here?
No,
should I get out of here?
You want to ask that out of there? Any more questions? But go ahead and pass that out.
Yeah, here's the something. People sometimes get confused. Oh, is this my week to recycle? Well, here you go. You won't be confused for the next year.
You need a few extra.
Yeah. I'm amazed you take part.
They go in the bulky waste bins out back.
If it's a good piece of furniture, do you donate it?
No, what we do is we don't take furniture in the swap shed anymore because we don't have the room. What I advise people, if you want to leave it here and you think it's good, you're going to pay for it. If you're going to leave it here, you're going to pay for it. If you think it's good, take it to Salvation Army or down to the ReStore and Carver, and very often they'll say, well, they don't want it. And I say, well, why do you think we would want it? Any more questions?
Well, thank you, Jim.
Well, no, I thank you. I thank you all.
As I mentioned, our speaker is for August. It is
The date is August 11th, and it's going to be Kimberly King in Harrytown, and that's going to be strictly on wood ticks because of the diseases and what's happening in Lyme disease. And if you ever get a piece of that, you know what we're talking about. And Harrytown has had really had life with this Lyme disease. So that's why he's part of it, because he can tell you what he had to go through, what they did for him, and how he's going about it right now. So if you're interested at all in ticks and Lyme disease, it's going to be a good meeting that we have at that time. That's going to be on August 11th. So before we go, I just want to, Joe always wants to know, I'm going to be reading my little article that I read.
Oh, yes.
Joe, are you interested in hearing this one?
I most certainly am.
Joe's hearing everything.
This one here is called The Slice of Heaven.
Uh-oh. Here we go.
Three men were stranded on an island with nothing to eat except for one piece of bologna. They decided whoever had the best dream that night would get to eat the bologna, one piece. The next morning, Tom said he dreamed he was in heaven and sang with the angels. Kevin said he dreamed he was in heaven and played the golden harp. The other fellow says, well, I dreamed that you two guys died and I went and ate the bologna. So thank you all for coming. And we appreciate everybody coming to Triad. And if anybody has any subject they want to hear or any speaker, please let us know.